Morning, church.
Hey, church.
Welcome to our online service this morning. So great to have you with us.
Yes, happy Easter.
Happy Easter, yes. And we are so thrilled to that you've joined us.
Yes.
And I've been praying for you. We definitely miss you, seeing your faces.
So
it's definitely not the same.
It's not.
But we love that we can still speak to you through whatever medium it is. And so we're thrilled that you've joined us and are praying for you.
Yeah.
I know that this morning is going to be powerful, and as we worship together and unite in that front, that God's going to speak to each and every one of us individually.
Right.
So, church, why don't we stand? Why don't we just enter into a time of worship now and just allow His Spirit to fill each and every one of our homes.
Sing hallelujah, the Lamb is overcome.
sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is
their children, may his presence. So good to be worshiping together on this Resurrection Sunday, and what a beautiful day to be celebrating the resurrection of our King.
Yes.
And you know, this is such a significant weekend for us as Christians and just in the life of our church.
So
and we're just so glad that you have joined us online this morning. And hey, if you are here for the first time online, we would love to hear from you and just get to know you some more. So make sure you jump on the chat and say hi, or you can head to the New Here tab at the top and just let us know that you're here. We'd love to get in contact with you and just say thanks for joining us, get you involved in the life of our church if you're keen. So please let us know, and know that you are so welcome here, and we're really excited to have you.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. So this morning I just want to let you know about a couple of things that we are doing as a church to stay connected during this time. I know we can't see each other face to face, and that is so different, but there's still ways that you can stay connected with us as a church and that we can still do life together. So a couple of ways that we're doing that. One is our Connect groups.
Yes.
We love, love our Connect groups.
So true.
And we have groups that meet all over Queanbeyan. And at the moment, they meet in even more places because we're all meeting in our homes Zoom. So if you are not in a Connect group, make sure you sign up online for a group. It is the greatest way to get into community and to meet new people and to just do life with one another. And at the moment, we're meeting on Zoom. They happen during the week, mostly Wednesday and Thursday nights.
Yep.
It's so you can have a phone call, see people's faces, get to know people. We pray for one another.
Yep.
We have fun and laugh with each other.
Totally.
And it's just such a great way to keep connected during this time. So this week coming up, it is Connect Week. So make sure you sign up if you're not already in a group. And if you are in a group, make sure you are on your Zoom call, because it will be so much fun.
Yeah.
And we would love to have you a part of it.
Yes.
The other thing that we are doing is reading the Bible together. So good.
Love reading the Bible.
So you can join us. We have been reading a plan that finishes tomorrow. And so on Tuesday morning, we're going to be starting a new plan together on the Bible app, which is about the promises of God. So you can join us by heading to bible.c3queanbeyond.com.
Yep.
And together we read a Bible devotional plan. And it's so much fun. You get to get into the Word of God, develop that daily habit for yourself. But also we get to chat about it over the app and what we've gotten out of it that day and pray for each other. And it's just such a great tool that we can use to stay connected in this time. So sign up for Connect Groups. Sign up for the Bible app.
Yes.
Two great things that we're doing, right? Yep, awesome. So good. Okay, well, we are going to hear in a very brief moment from this guy bringing the word. But before that, we have a C3 story. So enjoy.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jodie, and I'm one of the Queanbeyond Connect leaders. I've been coming to C3 Church for about 2 years now and I've been loving every second of it. My walk in faith, I have found, has been quite similar to a lot of other people's stories, and yet it's unique in its own way, as I'm sure God has intended it to be. I did not grow up in a Christian family, and yet I always had the feeling that church is where I needed to be. I used to drag my mum along to church on a Sunday morning just so I could go to Sunday school. And then it progressed to me as a teenager going to youth group without ever really questioning why I enjoyed it so much. In retrospect, I know why. But by the time I hit about 16, I was at an all-time low. I'd been bullied for many years by that point and had been diagnosed with major depressive disorder and anxiety. Just waking up every day was a challenge to get out of the house and drag myself to school, which was my own personal battleground. To put it simply, I was suicidal. I'd been going to a Christian adventure camp for quite some time by this point, and after a recent suicide attempt, I decided to go back because I knew out in the wilderness, that was where I felt most connected to God. On the last night of that week at camp, the leaders played Lifehouse's Everything Skit, and it changed my life. I'd been feeling so heavy for so long that I didn't know what it felt to be light again. There was a feeling in that moment of just lifting that weight off my shoulders and feeling light. It changed my life. From there, the biggest change in my life was that I recovered completely from my major depressive disorder. I stopped having suicidal tendencies and I started to look forward to life again. In church, I have found a family I never thought I would have that has challenged me to grow in my faith. I've discovered that I have the gift of discernment, which manifests in seeing angelic powers over moments in people's lives. I've seen prayer come to fruition, even my own. My journey has been full of ups and downs. It's not perfect and it never will be. But I can tell you that now my life is far better with Christ than I ever was without Him.
Good morning, church, and welcome to our Easter Sunday service. It's so great to have you with us. And I'm so thrilled that you're joining us from wherever it is that you're joining us from this morning. We are missing all of your beautiful faces, and I've been praying for you regularly, and I'm personally missing your warm embrace. So a big virtual hug for you all this morning. Maybe just hug your spouse or your friend or whoever it is that you're sitting with this morning, but hug your teddy bear. But our heart is for you, and we are completely missing you, missing our corporate gatherings. But so thrilled that we can actually be with you online this morning. And also a lot online connect groups have been going on during the weeks. And I know that those have been special times as well of just connection with each other. And as we just navigate this new season of socially distancing and making sure that we're doing things right, I know that our groups are a gathering and are able to just to keep that connection up and going. So if you're not in a Connect group, please visit our website and sign up for one. We'd love to get you into one so that you can remain connected in this time, and that you can be heard, and you can be pastored and looked after, and all that sort of thing. So make sure you do that. I'm really excited about bringing the word this morning, and the title of my message, if you're taking notes, is The Weekend That Changed the World. And this weekend, Easter weekend, it quite literally is a weekend that changed the world. It is all over the world. We're gathering in churches. There's people that are taking time off. We have changed all sorts of things to allow this weekend to be what it is. And, you know, on Good Friday, we mourned the fact that Christ went to the cross. But on Sunday, Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, we rejoice in the fact that that wasn't the end of the story. The story just is beginning with the new life that he has for each and every one of us. And he actually rose from the dead. It doesn't finish at his death. It just begins in the fact that he rose. And, you know, our doctrine in C3 is hinged around the fact that Jesus took, his life was taken for each and every one of us, that we can have freedom to approach his throne. And it's through him that we can achieve everything. And so we're so grateful that you're here. And I'm just going to pray this morning as we come around his word. God, I thank you that your word is more powerful than a two-edged sword. Lord, that it can pierce hearts, even through the internet. God, I thank you for each and every person, Lord, that's listening this morning. Lord, that they would have a new revelation, a new understanding of your love for them. Lord, that it was poured out on the cross for each and every one of them. Lord, and we thank you, Jesus, for enduring the cross for us, that you saw our faces, that you saw our futures, that you know us and you knew us and you wanted that relationship with us so much that you went to the cross for us. We're so thankful. We're so grateful, Lord, and we just give you glory and praise this morning in Jesus' name. You know, as I was reading and praying and just seeking God this week for what he was wanting me to speak to and speak into, and as I was reading through the Bible and through the different versions of the Passover and the crucifixion story, which can be found in the Gospels. If you didn't know, you can read all it through the Gospels. But I was reading Mark chapter 16 during the week, and something really spoke to me out of that scripture, and that's what I wanted to bring to this morning. So if you've got your Bibles, Mark chapter 16, verse 1 to 5, and I'm going to read from the Message version, which says, "When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they could embalm him. Very early on Sunday morning, as the sun arose, they went to the tomb. They worried out loud to each other, 'Who will roll back the stone from the tomb for us?' When they looked up, they saw it had already been rolled away. It was a huge stone, and they walked right in. They saw a young man sitting at the right side, dressed all in white. They were completely taken aback, astonished." You know, there's three things that I wanted to bring out of the scripture for you this morning. And the first one, if you're writing notes, you can write this down, is that we actually need to look up. We need to look up. And you can look up and you might see a ceiling in your home today. You might see the roof of your car. I don't know where you're watching from. But, you know, we actually need to look up. We need to look to Christ for everything that's going on in our world. You know, in verse 4, it says that they worried out loud to each other, saying, "Who will roll back the stone from the tomb for us?" You know, we can fill our lives with anxiety. We can fill our lives with worry. We can look to the left and the right. We can look for help and guidance from all sorts of different ways. But the very fact is that we actually can look up to God, who actually has the answers for us. He's written, you know, an amazing book called The Bible, which I recommend you read. And he can actually give you answers in all sorts of different circumstances that you might find yourself in. You know, I read this quote this week. It says, "You cannot breathe the air of anxiety and expect to live in an atmosphere of peace. And, you know, that quote was from Stephen Furtick, but it really spoke to me about what we're actually breathing, what we're actually taking on board, what we're actually reading, or what we're actually bathing ourselves in, actually allows us and puts us in a place of the atmosphere that we're gonna live in. And so if we're wanting to live in a place or an atmosphere of peace, we actually need to be breathing in new air. We need to be breathing in something that's going to allow us to live in that place of peace. So we need to change what we're breathing. We need to change what we're speaking. And often we talk about needing to take our eyes off of our own situation and actually putting them on God. This might be the perfect time for you to take your eyes off of your current situation and actually allow God to speak to you and allow him into the situation that's going on in your world. You know, it might be due to coronavirus and you might be worried and you might be just anxious about what this is going to look like. You know, it might be with your relationship with your spouse or with one of your friends. You know, there might be things going on there that just need an outside perspective. It needs a God revelation to come in. You know, you might be struggling at your job. There's so many different aspects of our world that we can actually find ourselves wrestling with and find ourselves in a place where we just don't know what the next step is. And my encouragement to you this morning is to look up. Look up out of your situation. Look up from the ground. Look up from the left and the right, the counsel that you might be receiving from friends or family. Look up to Christ and allow him to speak to you in a new way, to allow his revelation, and his love, his peace, his joy to fill that situation. That anxiety, that depression, that feeling that you've got can be extinguished through his love, can be extinguished through the goodness that he has for you. And it's actually all due to the fact that Christ took all of that on the cross for each and every one of us. You know, there's many times that we can look at our own hopeless situation. There's many times that we can look at the lack that we have in our own wallets. There's the lack of, you know, money that we might be needing to pay that bill. There's self-pity. There's my needs, my wants, the me, me, me. I've talked about it a few times at church before, that we live in a me, me, me generation. What can I get out of the situation? What can I do? But we actually need to take our focus off of ourselves. We need to look up, and we actually need to allow Christ to have reign in whatever that situation might be. I know there's been times in my life where I can and get into a thought pattern that takes me down a road that I don't even want to go down, and I can make up complete and utter concoctions in my mind as to what the situation is going to turn out like. And I've been known, and I've talked about it with my wife a few times, of stories where I've made up the entire situation to only then come out and actually have the actual situation play out. It doesn't look anything like it. And I've sat in this place of worry and anxiety, thinking about all the things that could go wrong, will go wrong in it. And I actually haven't taken that to God and allowed him to wash over it. And, you know, I found myself in a place of just being suspicious or wondering or worrying about what a person might be thinking about me or how a situation at work might turn out. And if I had only gone to God in those moments and just given it to him, and this is something that I've learned over the years, that as I've taken those things to him, that he actually comes in and he removes that worry, he removes that anxiety, and he fills that place with peace. And, you know, his word says that his peace transcends all understanding, which means that his peace is bigger than any situation that you could be going through right now. And so whether you've, you know, lost your job, which I'm praying for you, and we're interceding for you and praying that God would reach out to you as well, if there's been loss in your life, or, you know, there's just something that's blocking you from your relationship with him, I'm praying that as you begin to look up out of your situation, and you look up at God and allow him to just wash over you, that he will reach in a whole new way. You know, I've been reading a Bible plan on YouVersion. You can download the app and join us as well. But it's called God's Umbrella of Protection. And it's really opened my eyes again afresh to the revelation that Christ or that God actually wants to protect us, that God actually has big arms that are out there to protect us and look after us and care for us. And, you know, in verse 14 of Psalm 91, which we're going through, it says, "Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name." You know, talking about us loving him, talking about us acknowledging him. And as we do those things, as we acknowledge him, as we love him, he actually promises to rescue us. He promises to protect us. He offers his shelter around us. And so I find that really encouraging, especially in this time where we are really uncertain of what this thing is going to turn out like, and where we're going to end up in 3 to 6 months, what the world's going to turn to and how the economy is going to outplay. There's so many factors that are going on that might be plaguing your mind. But as we focus in on God, as we look up out of our situation and we allow God to wash over it and to fill us, we actually find ourselves in a place of peace, knowing and trusting in him that he will guide us through, he will pull us through, he will be there with us. So my encouragement to you this morning is to look up. Number two is that it's already been done. You know, faith allows us the ability to see what God has already done, where he's already won, where he's already had the victory. You know, and that stone that they're talking about, they wanted that stone to be removed, might represent something so different for each and every one of you. You know, I don't know what that stone looks like, and I'd encourage you to have a look and have a think about what that stone might represent in your life. Is it a blockage that's blocking you from walking into your future with him? Is it a blockage that's holding you back from walking into a relationship with him? Is it sin that's holding you back? Is it a past experience, or is it fear? You know, there's so many things that that stone could represent in each and every one of our lives. And the thing is that stone has actually already been removed. You know, it's been removed. There's nothing that blocks us from accessing God's throne. There's nothing that blocks us from accessing his throne. We have complete freedom. That stone has been blown up. It's been removed. It's already out of the way. And so whether it's forgiveness and you're holding on to something that's that was said to you and you've been offended, or you've you know, there's a family member that you're offside with, or whether there's that guilt that's plaguing you for whatever it is that you said the other day, or, you know, a past experience, or just something that's going on in your life at the moment, there is nothing that can hold you back from stepping into your relationship with God. There's nothing that's holding you back from his love for you. That stone doesn't exist. It is completely and utterly gone because of Christ's work on the cross for you. You know, God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we imagine. And, you know, and I've got some big thoughts, and I would imagine that some of you have got some massive thoughts. And to think outside of the fact that God can blow those things out of proportion and can exceedingly abundantly do more than often blows my mind, that I can be so tied up in my little thinking that the bigger picture of what God's actually doing in and around me can often be blinded, and I can be blinded by. And I love the fact that Christ's work on the cross actually allows God to move in my life and to do more than I could even imagine. And that blockage that, you know, that I might place between me and God, I know has been actually removed. It's been taken away. And, you know, for me, it probably took a while for me to understand and realize the fact that there isn't a blockage between me and God. You know, I grew up in church. I grew up knowing about God. I knew and I had a whole lot of head knowledge. But it wasn't until I got a revelation that his love for me is so great that there is nothing that I have done or nothing that I'm going to do that will stop me or prohibit me from stepping into his presence. And that goes the same for each and every one of you. There's nothing that you've done. There's nothing that you're currently doing, or there's nothing that you're going to do that will hold you back from entering into a relationship with him, from being free in him. And I just love the fact that that's what Christ's death and his resurrection actually means for us, that we have complete and utter freedom to approach him. So number two was, it's already been done. God has already done it. He's, as we keep our eyes focused on him, it's already been done. And point number three this morning is, we can walk right in. Now, at the end of that verse, it says that it had been rolled back and it was a huge stone and they walked right in. They walked right in, and you can walk right into your future with God this morning. You can walk right into your future with him during the week. There's nothing that's holding you back. As you look up out of your situation, as you forget and physically remove that stone from yourself, that you can actually step into your future with him. You know, for me, it probably took me a number of years to realize the fact that Christ's work on the cross actually allowed me that freedom to walk into my future with him. And there were plenty of times where I've looked back on past decisions and things that in my mind I had thought held me back from actually stepping into a future with him. And there's been plenty of conversations that I've had over the years that, oh, what about this and what about that? But there, at the end of the day, there was nothing in the Word of God that put me into a place where I was not accepted or not able to walk into my future with him wholeheartedly. There's nothing that I've done. There's nothing that I could do that would hold me back. And that's the same for each and every one of us. We have complete freedom because of Christ's work on the cross for us. And I love the fact that that Jesus's work on the cross gives us freedom to approach God's throne with confidence and boldness, knowing that he actually hears us. It's not a God that's distant and away from us. He is actually present with us and wants to have that relationship with us and wants to commune with us. And this morning, you know, you might not have made a decision to follow Christ, and you might not have invited him into your life. And I want to give you the opportunity to do that this morning. And so we're going to pray a prayer together. And it's a prayer of inviting Christ into your life. And you can hit the little button that's just popped up on your screen just to say that you're making that decision, so that we can follow you up and pray with you and help you on your journey. We can also give you a free book called Following Jesus that will help you on your journey with him. But this morning, if that's you and you need to make a decision to follow Christ, please pray this prayer with me. It's a prayer that just lets go of our past and allows him to just have full reign of our life. And, you know, you might have made this decision once before and, you know, you've walked away from God and you've been invited back to church this morning. And, you know, you can pray this prayer this morning and you can get your life right with Christ. You know, you might find yourself in another category of people that have made this decision, but you just don't know that you're going to heaven. Pray this prayer this morning and you will have assurance that heaven will be your home. Say these words after me. Jesus, I ask you into my life. I ask to be born again. Make me your child. Forgive me of my sins. Help me to follow you. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Amen. Let me just pray for you this morning. God, I thank you for each and every person that made this decision this morning to follow you. Lord, whether it be a first-time commitment, whether it be a rededication, Lord, whether it's just the assurance that was needed. Lord, I thank you that you're writing their name in your Lamb's Book of Life. Lord, that they have eternity in you. Lord, that they have a new hope in you. Lord, I thank you that as they step out into this week, Lord, that as they look up out of their situations, as they see that stone's been obliterated, Lord, that they can walk right in to their future with you this morning. Amen. Amen. Hey, church, if you made that decision and you wanted to find out any more information, please head to our website or write to us on email or click that button below. As I said before, we'd love to get in contact with you and give you a free book and just help you on your journey and your relationship with Christ. But That's it from us this morning. We hope that you've enjoyed our church this morning, and we are praying for each and every one of you, and praying that you would have a great week, that as we navigate this distancing, that you'd still find connection. And I'd encourage you to visit our website again and find out more information about our Connect groups so that you can remain connected in this time. But God bless you, church. We love you, and we'll see you next week.